In this section of our Worldviews and Values class, we are focusing on a work by an ancient philosopher, Epictetus, who was a Stoic. And we're going to look at the discourses. We're only going to look at certain sections of those that fit in well with the key themes of the class, because I don't want to overwhelm you with too much material. And those key themes, of course, are human nature, society, and the underlying and encompassing reality in which human nature and society are unfolded and ought to be understood. The Stoics had some very clear, interesting, and definitive ideas about these sorts of things. Epictetus is one of the most powerful articulators of this, so we're going to look at the things that he has to say. Before we go into that, a little bit about, I mentioned that he's a Stoic. That's a school of philosophy, and it emerges in the ancient period. It's really coming out of Socrates by way of this guy Zeno, who is not a student of Socrates, but is actually several students removed from Socrates, but he's studying with guys who studied with Socrates. And Stoicism was not just a philosophy in the sense of, well, here's, you know, a picture of the world, and, you know, we can encompass it in this book. Stoicism was understood as a way of life, a way of understanding how we ought to live, a way of making progress as human beings towards our good, towards freedom, towards serenity, towards a happy life, towards possession of what it is that's most valuable. And that means, you know, making choices that take us away from things that we think are valuable, but actually turn out to not be so. We'll talk more about that in some of the other videos. Now, Stoicism begins in the ancient world, and there's periods in which it's dominant as a school of philosophy, and then there's periods where it's in decline, and even, you know, you might say out of sight. But it leaves an important trace within the history of philosophy, and that means the history of human ideas all the way down to the present time. You might not know this, but there are people that we can identify as neo-Stoics, that means, you know, Stoics in the modern times, who found these ideas, particularly those of Epictetus, incredibly valuable, and a lot of them aren't philosophers. Admiral Stockdale, a military officer who used Epictetus's Enchiridion, and what he memorized of it when he was a cadet at West Point, to survive 5 years of terrible prison camp in the Vietnamese War, writes extensively about what he got out of Stoic philosophy. And a lot of military people have been quite attracted to Stoicism. Tom Wolfe, who this came out of interviews with Stockdale, wrote a book called The Man in Full, is recounting what a prisoner makes of finding Epictetus and trying to apply this to prison life. On a personal note, I'll mention, as you know, I've been in my past involved in prison philosophy. I've known prisoners whose outlook on life was radically altered by their encounter with Epictetus and with Stoicism, who practiced Stoicism within the prison. Stoicism has even led to forms of psychotherapy and to also forms of acting in the modern age. The psychotherapy I'll mention, Albert Ellis, the founder of rational emotive behavior therapy, which then becomes cognitive behavior therapy. There's a whole bunch of loosely associated ideas with this. He draws heavily on Epictetus. He says this is applied Stoicism. So these are ideas, and these are our perspectives on the world and on values that have incredible application. Just recently, I participated in Stoic Week, which is organized by the University of Exeter. I did a series of videos. If you're interested, I can link to those in other places. Did a series of videos as my contribution to Stoic Week 2014. But they've actually put together a whole course, a week-long course, on how to try to improve your life by using Stoic philosophy. So, you know, in the ancient period, all the way down to the present, it's been seen as something that for certain kinds of people can be incredibly effective. There is one other thing I would like to say about Epictetus before we go into the nuts and bolts of this particular video. Epictetus, in a certain way, symbolizes Stoic philosophy in his life. And I don't just mean that he applied it in his life, or he practiced it, or he was a consistent teacher. What I mean is he starts out as a slave and ends up a philosopher being sought out by people like the emperor, and goes through all sorts of things along the way. Now, why would that be like Stoicism? Well, Stoicism teaches that in many respects, we're slaves without even realizing it. And it's through coming to understand human nature and what it is that we really are and what we're not actually about and what we can, you know, put aside, the choices we have to make, that we become liberated. And eventually we can become, as the Stoics wanted us to be, wise. And wisdom is not something just all purely in the head. It's in our attitudes and our actions. Now, the Stoics understood that emotions and attitudes and thoughts are, in fact, you know, closely connected together. That's why it leads to cognitive behavior therapy, among other things. But Epictetus is really, through his life is a figure of what Stoic philosophy is trying to offer to us. Now, that said, there's three things that I want to talk our way through a little bit. These are the things that we want to focus on with every text that we approach in this class. There's the genre of the text, there's the historical context, and then there's the key ideas. And all of these, you know, fit in with each other, but we can distinguish them and we can treat them separately. So let's look first at genre. What kind of text is this? As you're approaching it, you notice that it has books and chapters, and those books, that's the way they divided texts in the ancient period. Books were scrolls, you know, so whatever you could actually fit onto a scroll, that was a book, and then it's divided into chapters. And I haven't given you all of the chapters of the discourse because I don't want to overwhelm you. It's pretty long, dense work. But I do strongly suggest that after this class is over, you know, if you found something valuable here, go back to the text and get the actual copy of the discourses and read through it. You might also find useful the Enchiridion of Epictetus, which is really a bunch of passages taken out of the discourses. And sometimes it's called the Golden Sayings. And they've excerpted them and put them into a little order so that you can have it as a handbook. That's what it means, Enchiridion. Greek for hand is chair. We translate that as care, right? And so the Enchiridion, the little thing that goes into your hand, is in fact a book, like this. That's what an Enchiridion is. So let's talk a little bit more about genre. What kind of text are we dealing with here? So it's called discourses. That should be a clue right there. Discourses means something that is spoken, something that is said. Epictetus didn't write this text himself. He said the words, according to his biographer, well, not quite biographer, but narrator, Arian, his student, who recorded these things and says that he's transmitted them faithfully. Whether he did or not, we don't really know. We're going to just assume that he did because we have no grounds to think that he didn't. But this guy Arian, he's a student of Epictetus, and Epictetus doesn't write anything down. Arian does write this stuff down, usually after class. People had much better memories than we did back then. They did a lot of memory training, so you don't have to worry about, you know, did he do it faithfully, or did he make this stuff up? What we have here, then, is a set of spoken discourses. They're not dialogues, because for the most part, Epictetus is actually addressing the audience. And it can be an audience of a bunch of students. It can be somebody who came to see him, so he's talking to one person, perhaps in front of other people, and we're getting to look in on the talk. It could be the reader today that we're thinking about is being addressed. In most cases, he's talking about a specific issue or a particular idea that's important in Stoicism. But you'll notice that he comes back to the same basic ideas time and time and time again, because this is a set of conversations that he is having with his students and trying to get them to see the same ideas from different sides. So, you know, when you see repetition in here, that should be something that clues you in. Aha, this is probably something important. If he's going to keep on talking about preconceptions, I should probably pay attention to that. Another thing that you do want to keep in mind is because these are spoken discourses from a wide range of times, there isn't really any attempt to be systematic in the organization of them. But there is a system underlying all these talks and ideas. Epictetus does have a coherent worldview that he is transmitting to us through these discourses, and I'll be talking about important parts of those in the other videos. So that's probably enough about genre at this point. These are all things to keep in mind, though, as you're reading through it. Now, historical context. Epictetus is writing, you could say, in many respects, in the glory days of the Roman Empire. The empire actually hasn't been around as the empire all that long by the time that he's on the scene. He's born in AD 55, dies around 135 or so. So he's in that period where Rome has gone from being a pretty dysfunctional republic to being an imperium ruled by one person, the originally it's Julius Caesar, right? And each of the ones after him gets called a Caesar. But they're also called the emperor, they're also called the dictator. And the idea is that you have one person ruling, and then power flows down throughout the rest of society. Meanwhile, Rome is expanding and expanding. And something that you do want to take into consideration here, you know, with Plato, he's writing at the time of the Greek city-states, when Athens was its own independent entity. True, it did have an empire. It ruled other city-states for a while, pretty despotically. It's part of what got them, you know, attacked by the other city-states. But, you know, the Greeks at that time were split into a bunch of different city-states, polises. Now, the Roman Empire was a power structure and also a culture and economic structure that would take in portions of city-states or other nations and assimilate them. Oftentimes, they didn't make drastic changes. They didn't, you know, force people to give up their religion or their local customs, unless they were really causing trouble with Roman rule. So, you know, one group that they really had a lot of trouble with were the Jews in Judea. There were some clashes that took place. The Greeks had this problem, too, with the various empires that were around as well. And the Romans had trouble with several other groups as well. But for the most part, it was so long as you paid your taxes, and your taxes could be pretty high, and they could be pretty unfair in how they are administered. There's a whole conversation to have there. But so long as you paid your taxes, didn't revolt, and allowed the sort of progress that Rome wanted to see take place, they'd pretty much leave you alone. They'd leave things up to the local administrators. So what you've got there is Epictetus is part of a world culture. Now, he's a Greek speaker. And you might say, well, then he must have been a second-class citizen. Well, you know, the entire eastern half of the Roman Empire, with the exception of the parts that were speaking Aramaic, if you go a little bit further east, or Coptic, you know, in Egypt, was Greek-speaking. And Greek was used as a literary language. A lot of, you know, Romans learned Greek. Cicero is a good example of that. Epictetus was sort of inheriting this entire culture that he's born into. Now, Epictetus is actually a slave. his name means piece of property. It may not even be his given name. And he starts out in this place called Hierapolis, which is not even in Greece. It's in what's called Asia Minor at that time, or Phrygia. And nowadays we call that area Turkey. So it gives you an idea of just how far away he is. And he's a slave there. His owner, and by the way, his owner was originally a slave too. His owner was a freedman who comes to Rome and eventually becomes the secretary to Nero, the Roman emperor. His name was Epaphroditus. Now, Epictetus is eventually allowed to start studying philosophy, and he begins to study under this Roman guy named Musonius Rufus. And if you wanted to, you know, be kind of fast and loose with names, Rufus means red, and Musonius is related to the word for mouse. You could call him the red mouse. And so Epictetus studies with him, and this guy's a Stoic philosopher. Now, Epictetus eventually is freed, and once he is, you know what he begins to do? He starts teaching philosophy. He's teaching in Rome. So it's sort of like, you know, the story of the common man made good who, you know, gets to start teaching at Harvard or makes it in the big time. And so he's teaching in Rome, and he's teaching Stoic philosophy, and he's getting lots of people to come and study with him, and he's living the Stoic life. He had endured a lot of hardships himself already. And then something happens. You know, the Roman Empire, you'd have shifts in power as the emperors were replacing each other. And the Roman Emperor Domitian, he banishes all the philosophers. He says, these guys are trouble. You need to kick them out. So he kicks them out of Rome, and he says, if you guys stay in Rome, it's the death penalty for you. So all the philosophers have to, you know, scatter everywhere else. Epictetus goes to Greece, and he settles in a place called Nicopolis, and he begins teaching again. And he continues that the rest of his life. A lot of very important people recognize his earnestness, his intelligence, his talent, and they come and study with him. He even has an emperor, Hadrian, a later emperor, who becomes friends with him and wants to encourage him. So Epictetus is living this interesting life within the Roman Empire. He never marries. He, according to stories, he adopts a child who is going to be abandoned and has the child raised. He finds a woman to help him raise the child. Now, there's a few other things that are important as far as historical context that I'd like to point out. One is, this is a time in which the philosophical schools, which, you know, are starting out in Greece, particularly for the most part in Athens, although there were some others in other places, they're spreading out throughout the entire Roman Empire. They're kicked out of Rome, the teachers of philosophy, for a while, but that doesn't really last. And people would identify with these philosophical schools. I'm an Epicurean. I'm a Cynic. I'm a Platonist. I'm a Stoic. The people who tended to identify with Stoicism were the ones who had a very strong sense of duty and propriety, and you should do the right thing because it's the right thing without seeking any sort of reward for it. Why? Because that's going to make you a free person and keep you, you know, from worries and things like that. The Stoics actually taught a doctrine called cosmopolitanism, which literally means the world is my city. Or another way of putting that is every one of the people in the world is also my fellow citizen, and I have a connection with them as a human being. So the Stoic school is teaching and spreading all these ideas throughout the Roman Empire, even some parts outside of it. And it's really catching on. So Epictetus is a major player in that. Another thing that I do have to tell you about historical context, I've mentioned this a couple times, Rome, like most ancient societies, and really most societies throughout history, was a slaveholding society. And you'll see Epictetus over and over again calling somebody a slave. Now, you want to dissociate that from the understanding of slavery that we often get from antebellum American slavery, so before Civil War slavery, because it's not really quite the same thing. As you notice, Epictetus starts out as a slave, and he's actually owned by a guy who used to be a slave himself. You know, you could go back and forth from slavery to freed condition, and the children of slaves could actually hold great power at certain points. But a lot of people were enslaved, a lot of people were labor that belonged to another person, so you do want to sort of keep that in the back of your mind. You'll see Epictetus doesn't really question the institution of slavery in any sort of civic sense. He wants to free people from slavery to their desires, from slavery to anxiety. This is a good transition point for talking about some key themes. So let's think about what some of the key ideas that we want to get out of these readings are. You notice that one thing that the discourses begins with, and even the condensation of it in the Enchiridion is going to begin with, is this notion that some things are in our power and other things aren't in our power, and we'll screw our life up if we don't learn to recognize the difference between those two and make ourselves very unhappy. We'll be slaves, in essence, to all those other things that can make us unhappy, unless we recognize this. So that's one key theme. Another one that you're going to see is his talking about over and over again moral purpose or the will as what we really have control over. And this is a translation of a Greek term that we're going to talk about later called proeresis. But I just want to put that on your radar for a moment, because he'll talk about the good life as being one where our moral purpose is in accordance with nature. He doesn't mean nature like getting out there and camping or anything like that. He means in accordance with what our human potential really is, what our true nature is. Epictetus also sees the good life, and this is a third theme, as something that we have to work hard and make progress towards. It's not something that, you know, he tells you the secret and now boom, you've got it. It takes a lot of thinking, it takes a lot of work, it's something that develops incrementally. Another thing that he is going to emphasize, and this is closely connected with the notion of moral purpose, is he's going to emphasize the rational or ruling part. Epictetus doesn't think, like, you know, for example, Plato does, that we have a whole bunch of different faculties in the soul. There's the ruling part, and then there's all this other stuff that we tend to share in common with the animals. And we want to focus on that ruling part and try to fix it up, try to improve it. Another key idea is, and I brought this up already, is that human beings are all, in a certain respect, brothers and sisters to each other. We're not just fellow citizens of the world as one big city. We're also in one big family. And why is that? Well, this is connected to Epictetus's and the Stoics' conception of religion and the divine. We all have a bit of God within us, according to Epictetus, and that little bit is the best part of us, and we can recognize it in other people. Now, when the Stoics are talking about God, they don't mean quite the same thing as, you know, Jews or Christians or Muslims do by it, or necessarily even what the other ancient Greeks meant by it. We'll talk about that a bit more in a video specifically devoted to that. Another key Stoic theme is that the good life is, in many respects, a life that is free from emotions, not necessarily all emotions, but certainly many emotions, because they tend to be upsetting and they tend to be reflections of the fact that we're worrying about things that we don't actually have control over and allowing them to upset us. So anger, fear, envy, all these sorts of things, we want to live a life without them. There's two other things that I want to bring up, and these are terms that you're going to come across in the reading. One is what gets translated as preconceptions or sometimes precognitions. And this is the idea of a prolepsis. And that literally means like how you, you know, grasp in advance. So there's certain, the Stoics thought that there were certain basic notions that all of us share. And these are pretty vague, but they're things like the good and the bad and the pleasant and the painful. Now, when we get down to particulars, that's when it gets really messy and we start to disagree with each other. But we all have these, some people like to call them innate ideas, as part of being a human being. We also, another key term that comes up is appearances or impressions. We also get stuff from the outside through the senses. And the Greek word for that is phantasia, though, that we get fantasy from that. So it can mean imagination, it can mean appearances, it can mean impressions. And the basic idea is, look, there's all this stuff that's impinging on us, sort of like my voice talking to you and the stuff that I'm talking about. That's all appearances. And you decide what you're going to do with that. So these are the key ideas. And like I said, if you get something out of this text in our study of it, these little portions of it, I can't strongly enough stress how good it would be to go and read the whole of the discourses on your own.